Welcome to my second video about color. As a little recap, we talked about the fact that we were, as artists, that we kind of lean into this traditional color theory. And I just really want to reiterate that this is a theory where we use the yellow and the blue and the red as our primaries. That's the traditional theory, but there are many other color theories out there. It's just the one that tends to be used the most, so we use it to communicate. We talked about the color wheel. We talked about identifying colors, the three qualities that we use to identify colors. So just if you know, we use the blue here, for instance, the outer edge of the ring, the first quality is its hue, which is just a fancy word for what's the color. Okay, so in this case, the hue is blue. We also talked about its saturation, which again is kind of the outer ring of this color wheel. How pure is the color? You know, how close to the outer ring is this color? The intensity, you know, or like I said, saturation. Of course, a muted color or a desaturated color, we're going to get closer probably to the color having qualities of sort of gray or graying out, right? And then we talked about its value. So this is also evident here on the inside, but is it a light blue? Is it a medium blue, or is it a dark blue? And then what the inner ring actually is on these color wheels is actually the tint, the tone, and the shade. So we also played around with that too in that video, where we add white, we create a tint of the color, we add gray, we create a tone of the color, and when we add black, we create a shade of the color. And then I also shared slides about seven color harmonies, or really seven color relationships. And that's really what I want to talk about today is, you know, it's well and fine that we can mix colors. It's great that we can identify them. But really, as artists, for me anyways, personally, the most important part is how do colors interact with each other? I've got sort of an exercise for you to do today, and I'll kind of walk you through it because, you know, we can talk about it, we can read about it, but I think really, it's about experiencing it, that it's sort of, for me anyways, it sort of becomes part of my knowing. And when I'm stuck at the canvas and things aren't working for me, then I can start to remember, oh yeah, if I have this color with this color, things start to change. And it can be really exciting, or it can be kind of frustrating. There is nothing absolutely reliable about the appearance of color. And in no context can we speak of color as it, quote, unquote, really is. Color is always determined by context. So speaking of that, let's build this exercise out, and we're going to need components for that. So it'll give us a chance to kind of do some color mixing here today too. We're going to start by creating three pieces of paper that are going to have the original saturated color, its tint, its tone, and its shade. So here's an example that I've made of blue. And then I'm going to ask you, depending on what color you choose, to also make one exactly like this of its complement. So in this case, it would be, I would have to make another one like this of orange. So we'll have, you know, this will be the second piece of paper. And then the third one will be a combination of the two, which are its neutral. And I just want to stop for 1 second and share that making a neutral between the two is just such a lovely way to create harmony in your work, because your darker areas or your lighter areas or your moody areas, they will be made of the two colors that you're kind of working with, right? And I kind of naturally tend to do this just because I work messy, and my brushes I'm not super clean with my brushes, so my colors will end up harmonizing just because I'm a bit of a mess. But it's a lovely little bit of magic, right? So rather than reaching for another tube of paint, you're actually creating those sort of colors that are supporting the color choices that you've made, right? By making this neutral. It's also a really great trick if you do want to desaturate a color. So say if you're working with a really bright orange, for instance, and you're just like, it feels a little bit too pop for me. Rather than reaching for, say, a gray or a black to kind of, you know, take it down and desaturate it, try actually adding a little bit of its complement. So add a little bit of its blue into the orange, and it feels a little bit weird, but it will kind of make it into a more of a mature version of the orange. And you can take that all, you know, you can go really far with that, and there's a huge wide range of colors that you can make from those two. So let's just switch the camera around so you can actually see, and I will make a neutral. So first off, I've got my palette knife, and I've got to, you know, to keep myself clean, because like I said, I am kind of messy. And I'm just going to ask you to make four strips. And if you're not messy like me, you might want to measure these out, but it doesn't really matter because we're just going to cut them up later. And I'm going to make a neutral between the two complements. So I have, I'm working with blue and orange. So let's just make the orange first, right? So if we just have our primaries, we need to make the orange out of our red and yellow. There we go. We got a nice orange color. So let's make a neutral now between our two complements. So I'm going to add orange and blue together. Let's take a little bit. And again, I'm just going to go slow with the blue because I have a feeling that my blue might just take over like it just did real fast. I could just stop like this. This could be my neutral. It's olive green, but I'm just going to play around for a little bit. This is totally subjective, right? You can decide how much orange or how much blue you want to, you know, use in your neutral. Just going to add a little bit more orange for curiosity's sake. It feels a little bit more brown-like now than it did before, so maybe I'll use this as my neutral just for fun and see what happens. So this is going to be my third kind of color. And what I'm going to ask you to do then is take a bit of your neutral and fill up one of these. I'm going to try to make it as even as possible for this exercise. I'm just thinking to myself, it might be easier if you did this with a brush. Now we're going to make a tint, a tone, and a shade. So the tint is going to be by adding a little bit of our neutral to white. Actually, a really beautiful, probably not that easy for you to see it on my overhead camera, but it is a really gorgeous, buttery, lovely color. All right, let's see what the tone looks like. So again, we're gonna go back to our neutral. And we're gonna add a bit of gray to it. I'm just gonna go slow. So I'm kind of, again, you know, my cameras are limited, but I've kind of made myself a really nice warm gray. And I would definitely recommend use a brush to apply this. Okay, and then last, using my neutral, I'm going to mix it with the black. And the gray was pretty darn powerful, so I'm going to use just a smidgen of my black I learned last time. Go slow. Let's see what this looks like. And again, I would definitely recommend you use a brush for this because I'm struggling with the palette knife, but... Okay, so now I have my neutrals. I have a blue piece of paper like this, an orange piece of paper like this, and my neutrals, which is the mixture between my two complements, my blue and my orange. And then what I'm going to do when they're all dry is I'm going to cut them up. So here's an example. I've cut up my orange, this out of the way, so it dries, into four strips. So here is its original color, saturated. Here is its tint, its tone, and its shade. And then I sliced off some from the bottom. maybe about an inch or so, not even maybe, like just, I'm just making little squares. You can see here, you can see that I'm not exactly very exact, squares or rectangles or whatever you want to call it. And then the last thing I'm going to do is I'm also going to slice off a larger square of each strip. So we can put the strips away, and this will be our material to use. We're going to have little tiny squares and larger squares. And my challenge, or my invitation for you, is to take the squares and use the larger ones in your sketchbook and arrange them so that you can start to play with two of the smaller squares inside the larger squares and see if you can change the quality of the color. So whether you change or alter its value by changing the background, they're identical, remember, these two little ones are identical, or you change the saturation level. Or if you're, you know, if it's really tricky, sometimes you can even, you know, take two squares and even make a color look the same. I know it sounds ridiculous, but let's just try with changing the value. And I'm just going to show you some magic in and around this, because I know this sounds kind of wild and nuts, but take a look at this. So this is a page out of Josef Albers' very famous book called Interaction of Color that was was published in the 1960s. He was an artist, but he spent his entire life studying and teaching color theory. He used colored pieces of paper. Okay, so that's not paint. This is paper. This is why I've asked you to make paper swatches of the red, the orange and the blue, and it's neutral, because I want you to play with these swatches to see if you can alter the color. Because believe it or not, the orange, kind of browny orange square on the left and the orangey square on the right are the same piece of paper that's lying underneath those two strips of the yellow and the dark blue. So that is the same color. Those two small orangey browny squares are the same piece of paper. So this is where, you know, I talk about color relationships, and we talk about sort of the psychology of it and the magic behind it. One of them, to me anyways, looks kind of browny color. It looks very desaturated, almost closer to grays, because it's lying on top of a very a more saturated version of the orange, and it's also got a light yellow beside it, so its value is challenging. It feels darker. The other one is on blue, its complement, and so it looks more orange to me. It looks brighter. It looks more saturated, and it also looks lighter because of the dark blue that's beside it. So color relationships, this is what I'm going to ask you to do, is to play with these swatches that you've made. You've made the, like I said, the two complements of your choice, plus a neutral in between. Cut them up, lay them out, play with them, and see if you can try to use the same tiny two little, you know, squares, and see if you can change that color. You know, you've created sort of a new color relationship between these swatches. It can be kind of tricky and maybe sometimes a little frustrating, but for me, it's just really been the best way for me to learn. And it's not like I've memorized all of this, if you put this with this, it's going to change. But what ends up happening is when I am working and, you know, I've made a color and I'm putting it on there and I'm working with it, and then some other color comes in at some other point, and I'm really happy with how those are interacting together, or maybe suddenly this color that I was hoping would kind of pop or come to the foreground or whatever, is not doing that anymore. And then I was like, oh yeah, color relationships. What's happening? What's happening around this color to maybe change or alter it? You know, and it's also part of the sort of, like I said, sort of the magic of it all, right? When you know, a lot of artists will put a really bright, intense, you know, orange underpainting under something that they know is going to be cool tones like blues and greens, because even if that most of that orange gets covered up, if tiny little bits of it peek out, it'll support the cool colors. It'll make, rather than just having white underneath, it'll make those cool colors come alive. So color relationships. Thanks so much for joining with me this video, and have fun color mixing and have fun discovering new relationships.